The rest of the story. You've heard the story of the landing of the Pilgrims at Plymouth Rock. Now you're going to hear the rest of the story. It was no more than a dot on Captain John Smith's map. Plymouth, spelled P-L-I-M-O-T-H. Nobody aboard the Mayflower wanted anything to do with it. They'd been blown off course. They'd wound up in New England by mistake. Their destination had been a territory known as Virginia, in a warmer climate to the south. But that band of intrepid wayfarers that we've now come to know as the Pilgrims put in at Plymouth of necessity. I say there was a reason that they stayed at Plymouth rather than continuing south to Virginia. I'll tell you about it in a minute. Had it not been for that certain something, the history books would certainly read differently. William Bradford's journal, his own painstaking, handwritten, first-hand account, tells us the rest of the story. The so-called Pilgrims of the Mayflower may be history's most misunderstood people. In the first place, it was not until the mid-19th century, more than 200 years later, that the group ever came to be known as Pilgrims. In 1620, they called themselves the Saints, or the Strangers. The former looking to the New World for religious freedom, the latter in search of economic opportunity. But here's something I'll bet you never realized. Our forefathers on the Mayflower were the original fun guys. I mean, really. Again, it was 200 years later that the likes of Longfellow and Emerson characterized them as great, grim, earnest men. Likewise, the artists of subsequent generations depicted them as solemn-faced and super pious, dressed in dull grays and blacks. Well, on the Sabbath, maybe. But during the other 6 days, no way. Historian Joseph P. Cullen reminds us that these folks were the products of a light and lively Elizabethan England, not the dour Victorian England of years later. They dressed in the browns and the greens and the blues, characteristic of the era's English yeomen. After all, they were mostly simple folk, farmers, laborers. And these that some historians had imagined to be the utterly pious pilgrims were in fact outspoken and witty. Their conversation was rich with earthy expressions, typical of Shakespearean English. They espoused no doctrines of self-denial. To the contrary, they were hearty eaters and game players and irrepressible celebrators, as the frequency of their marriages and the birth of their children would indicate. The Saints and the Strangers, they were lovers, not fighters. They came to the New World to escape the rigidity of the Old World. What they wanted most was the freedom to do their own thing. In mid-Atlantic, the Mayflower had encountered one fierce storm after another, was blown off course. November 10, 1620... land was sighted. Next morning, the vessel rounded Cape Cod, dropped anchor in what's now Provincetown Harbor. About this time, some of the Mayflower folks started grumbling because the charter they held was for Virginia, and here they were stuck somewhere up north in what even then was known as New England. They would have gone on, they would have sailed south to their intended destination, except for two things. One was that winter was closing in on them. But I'll tell you something. The mainmost reason, and I have this in the handwritten record of the passenger who became their governor, William Bradford, whose scrupulous notes were edited for this account. Governor Bradford, the father of American history, records, quote, "They would have gone on, except the Mayflower had run out of beer. And now you know the rest of the story."